reading various parts of Isaiah. And again, we're going to go back to Isaiah 9:6 as our starting place. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. And we've been looking at the various names identified here. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. Isaiah 35, the entire chapter, all 9 verses of it. The desert and the parched land will be glad. The wilderness will rejoice and blossom. Like the crocus, it will burst into bloom. It will rejoice greatly and shout for joy. The glory of Lebanon will be given to it. The splendor of Carmel and Sharon, they will see the glory of the Lord, the splendor of our God. Strengthen the feeble hands. Steady the knees that give way. Say to those with fearful hearts, be strong. Do not fear, your God will come. He will come with vengeance, with divine retribution he will come to save you. And then the eyes of the blind will be opened, and the ears of the deaf unstopped. And the lame will leap like a deer, and the mute tongue will shout for joy. Water will gush forth in the wilderness, and streams in the desert. The burning sand will become a pool, the thirsty ground bubbling springs, and the haunts where jackals once lay, grass and reeds and papyrus will grow. And a highway will be there. It will be called the Way of Holiness. It will be for those who walk on that way. The unclean will not journey on it. Wicked fools will not go on it. For no lion will be there, no ravenous beast. They will not be found there, but only the redeemed will walk there, and those who the Lord has rescued will return. They will enter Zion with singing, and everlasting joy will crown their heads. Gladness and joy will overtake them, and sorrow and sighing will flee away. Let's pray. Holy God, we give you thanks for your words of encouragement and truth and life. Words that do not disregard the brokenness of our world, the brokenness and the bentness of our own lives in this world, but words that give us hope and a future. Words that are not to harm us, but to help us live this world, this kingdom world. So Spirit, we pray that you would continue to have these words marinate on us, just not as I preach, but through the course of this day and week, until they've accomplished all that you have purposed for it in this season of Advent. May the words of my lips be pleasing to you, but edifying to us, encouraging to us, equipping for us. We pray this in your holy name. Amen. Now I'm going to date myself here. Now, for some of you, it's not that dated. I get that. But 1987. It was a movie that was put out. That was a Thanksgiving movie, truthfully, called Planes, Trains, and Automobiles, starring Steve Martin and Canadian John Candy. And it was a journey of two men trying to get home in the States for Thanksgiving at the end of November. They were trying to get to a place where family gathered, to a place where they enjoy the food, the family, and the friendships. It's a journey. The movie is about these two men journeying through a bunch of mishaps, and we'll get to that story in a bit of the later in the sermon. But Maranatha has also been its own kind of a journey with maybe different planes or different trains or automobiles, maybe just cars, truthfully. Using Isaiah as our guide through the scriptures. A journey from one place to another, from the beginning to the end. It's a journey about growing and forming and shaping our faith in who we are as Christians and who is God for us. The journey towards Christmas Eve and Christmas Day, towards Christmas food and family. The journey towards remembering the birth of Jesus Christ and our faith being shaped and formed in that moment. A journey that we expect will end in a joyous celebration in less than a week, as I was reminded just this very morning. Christmas is less than a week away. So if you haven't bought your gifts, still time, but hurry. But the movie, Planes, Trains, and Automobiles, doesn't go well for Steve Martin and for John Candy's characters. They take taxis that are broken down. They take flights that are diverted. Trains are broken down in the middle of a field. And automobiles actually catch on fire. You have to see it to enjoy it. It's a three-day journey for the main characters where absolutely nothing goes right according to their plan. They get burglared. They get arsoned. They get rejected. And they stumble their ways back to Chicago. In some ways, it takes them further and further away from their destination, but ultimately it brings them back. Seems like in Christmas, we're creeping closer and closer to Christmas, but the Advent season seems harder and harder. We've struggled this week with Arctic temperatures, minus 20s. We've had diminishing daylight hours, and this week is the winter solstice, where we have the shortest number of daylight hours in the calendar year, making our world darker and darker. We've hoped for an end to the COVID pandemic restrictions, and yet more and more cases are arising, not just in our city or our province, but in our country as a whole, around the globe even. More and more cases of the latest variant are shutting down hockey and other recreational aspects. We'd hoped for the best in life, but it seems like the best we've got is only hope. It seems like we're in a desert where life is barren and bleak and there isn't much to go on. That Advent hope seems hopeless, like a stump that we talked about a few weeks ago. That Advent peace is actually in pieces and chaos and confusion. And last week we looked at how Advent love is maybe for some lost and lonely, separated. And the joy of Christmas just seems broken by the bitterness of the world in which we live. Now this isn't new to God's creation. And the text in Isaiah 35 speaks about how, you have to read it kind of a backwards, that looks forward thinking, but if you look at it in a reverse way, it speaks about how in verse 1 there's a wilderness, a desert, a parched land. In verse 3, there are feeble hands and knees that are giving way. People are just tired. Verse 4, there's fearful hearts. People are afraid of what's happening in them and to them. In verses 5 and 6, there's people who are blind, people who are deaf, people who are mute, there are people who are lame. There's not much going right in this world for Israel, as is written by the prophet Isaiah in chapter 35. Because for many of us, we want Christmas to be healthy and happy. But the reality is that healthy and happy for many are just a distant dream. Sometimes in looking ahead to the fun and the festivities of Christmas, we forget the chaos and the confusion of all the buying all the gifts, of wrapping all the paper, of eating too much bad food. And we look ahead to all of the credit card bills and garbage and recycling that's yet to come. We forget the temporary time out that Christmas brings in our hope, our peace, our joy, and our love. We accept the fact that Christ comes in this loving place of in the world as a baby. But sometimes we forget that the world is a harsh and hardened place, and we deny the reality of a sin-filled, pain-riddled, broken-down, suffering creation and existence. And as we've been diving through the season of Advent, it's not meant to emphasize the negative, but it's to recognize that we live in this broken down world that's causing some broken down feelings and emotions and places to be. A struggle to be, much less to move forward. So as we've done, we've sort of spent some time reflecting on some questions. Allowing just the reality of who we are to be honest with ourselves, with some of our discouragements, with some of our disappointments, with also some of our hopes and areas that we need help in. So I'm going to give you, again, as we've been doing, some time to either reflect on this if you're on your own. If you're comfortable as a group, do that as a group. Just reflect on what parts of your world are dry and distant from God, and what parts of your world are of your life and faith are lacking God's joy. Now, I'm going to be up front with you. This is not the end of the sermon. Up until this point, I've done this in the sermon. I'm not done already. A little bit more to go. But I want you to just reflect on this space as we move forward, and we will end with that video that has been we've been using as a transition place to move forward. So we're going to use that video after the reflection to sort of transition to what God says about this place. So think about this for a few seconds, and then we'll get back to it. the journey can be hard. And not even necessarily hard, but in a place of just, it's not fabulous, it's okay, but we want more. And it sort of speaks to where we want to go and how do we want to get there. So in Planes, Trains, and Automobiles, it's about a journey to home. Neil, Steve Martin's character Neil, is desperate on any level to get back to his family for Thanksgiving, to his wife and to his children. And he's partnered with John Candy, his character name is Dell, who's trying to get back to Chicago, and those reasons are unclear at the beginning of the movie, throughout the movie, but it becomes more obvious at the end where that's going for. But to be in a desert, just standing in a desert, isn't where we want to be. We want to be in a destination that gets out of the desert and goes to a healthier place. In our Advent journey, the journey is important, but so is the destination. Advent takes us ultimately to the Christ candle, to the Christ. Because God wants for his people, his creation, a journey that leads somewhere. And that somewhere is actually someone, him. The text speaks about to Zion itself, a place that Israel knew about as a place where God's presence dwelt, a place where God's kingdom was. It's a journey that I have walked various people in various churches near the last parts of their days on this earth. Elderly people whose bodies are decaying, their minds are decaying, still looking for a final hope in the world yet to come. A place where there's no more sorrow, no more sighing, and where healing for their mind and for their bodies happens finally and fully. They long for this place. They hunger for this place because this broken world, for them at that stage of their life, was done. And a better world in their faith lay ahead. God holds that out, that promise to Israel, a promise of how the journey will end, and ending with God in his kingdom presence forever. Verse 10 speaks of entering Zion into the Jewish people, as I said before. That was where God dwelt, the city of God. And Zion is described in Isaiah 35 as, in verse 1, there will be rejoicing. Verse 2, there will be blooming. And again, think of a flower with its bulb bursting up to the ground and then burning into glorious color. Verses 3 to 6, there will be healing and strengthening in the body. There will be courage in the heart. The things that weigh us down, the things that tear us apart, the things that burden us here in this world will be no more. And verse 10, there will be singing, loud singing, and there'll be everlasting joy, a joy that does not end. Imagine a world that points to what's right with God and with each other. It's a hope that many elderly in our faith community aspire for. But it's also a hope for those who continue to live, that in this life we live with abundant hope, with abundant peace, and abundant love, with a joy that reminds us of full and abundant life from God, with God, and for God. This destination is what not just elderly who are ready to move on to God's presence hunger for, but truthfully it's those of us who see heaven on earth hunger for as well. A place where all is right in this world, with God in our midst, with God in our place, and through us to the world around us. Now again, Planes, Trains, and Automobiles, to get from the desert to the direction, they had to take a number of different pathways. It included a whole different means of transportation. Now it's not a surprise when you put Steve Martin and John Candy together in anything, it's going to end up being a comedy. And it was. It is. Our direction is through Jesus. Our Advent takes us to the place where God manifests himself, incarnates himself in this world as one of us. It begins for us there. It begins for God long ago. But for our faith, it begins there because that's where we see God walking amongst us. Advent, as we talked about, speaks about arriving and becoming. It's a journey of faith that is emerging and developing and forming and shaping. Advent hopes, peace, and love are found in the joy of Jesus Christ. It birthed in us as he was birthed in the world. The text speaks of a way, a highway. Out of the desert to the destination. A way of holiness, a way of righteousness, a way that is trustworthy, a way that is secure. It's a plan created by God to redeem his people, a roadmap created by God to show his people how to get from where they are lost to a place where they will be found. Away from all the hurt and harm in the world to a place of help and hope beyond the world. And Jesus in John 14:6 says, I am the way. I am the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So Jesus is the definition of the full and complete journey from our lost space into our found space, from our hurt space into our healed space. Isaiah speaks to Israel again in chapter 9, verse 6, the names of God, where he speaks of himself as the mighty God. The God is mighty enough to point the direction and to help us get to the destination. Because only a mighty God could be both a series of steps to reconcile creation back to God and the power to accomplish those steps for us when we can't. God is the way. And only a mighty God could help us walk our way forward to him. Now, the end of the movie, for all of the... I didn't put it up there. I forgot which order I put these into now. Change things around. There we are. Yep. I'll go back to this. End of the movie. They get back to Chicago. Slightly burned clothing, no credit cards, luggage all tatters. And Neil, Steve Martin's character, drives off in a rental car to his family and friends. And he gets to the house and he realizes that his new best friend never said what he was going to do for Thanksgiving. So he drives back to the bus station and finds John Candy's character sitting still in the bus station. His wife had died 8 years ago and he had no family to go home to. So Neil invites John Candy back to his house to join with his family in a Thanksgiving dinner. That's joy. Joy from God is for you and in you and through you. And John Candy's character experienced that on this movie, whimsical Thanksgiving movie. But we too have the opportunity to experience that as well. This joy of the Lord. There is a joy found at Christmas that's more than just the temporary gift of presents. A joy that's more than just the satisfaction of food or more than the gathering of family and friends. And it's truthfully even more than the happiness we experience when we come and sing Silent Night holding a candle or opening gifts on Christmas Day. Joy is a deeper and richer understanding of the fullness of our lives. The text speaks of this joy in two different ways. In verses 2 and 6, the New International Version uses the word joy, and the Hebrew word is ranan. And ranan speaks about how it's to shout or to sing, to be surrounded by blooming and rejoicing. It's things that are happening around you. But in verse 10, the NIV translates the word shimha as joy, and its context is gladness, delight, and attitude. They are two words meaning the same thing, but they have different implications because one is a response to the circumstances. The things that we find in our life that we give shouting and we give praise and we give thanksgiving and celebration to. The other is an attitude regardless of the circumstance. Whether or not we get a Christmas gift, whether or not it's snow on Christmas Day, whether or not we have a job, whether or not that attitude gives us a sense of joy that goes deeper into our soul than just sheer mere happiness, which is good as well. But it's deeper and richer and fuller than that. Everlasting joy will be on your head, soaking through you and about you. Nehemiah 8:10. Do not grieve, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. Whatever joy we have in this world comes from God. We can choose God's joy to us, but we can't make joy happen. True joy, full joy, abundant joy, because it comes from God. And it is our strength when hard times come. Had a woman in a different church, Trudy Frankreiter. She's passed on now. That woman had a belly laugh that came from the deep parts of her soul. And when she laughed, you could not help but laugh with her. To her dying days in her 90s, having been predeceased by her husband for several years and dementia growing deeper into her mind and her body, she continued to laugh with the Lord. And Nehemiah 8:10 was what I preached on her at her funeral. We have this strength of the Lord because of who gives us this strength. Hebrews 12:2, Jesus, the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith, for the joy set before him, endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. The joy we get is the joy Jesus lived. And the blessing that is given to us in Romans 15:13, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. This joy we have from God for us transforms our meager world, our dark and dreary world, into a world of hope and healing, of life and faith. Because God has directed us out of the desert to our destination with him. Because God is mighty enough to make it happen. And that becomes where we shout and sing in joy. And that's the basis of our faith. It's a joy that we look forward to this coming week, not just on Christmas Day as a family, but every day with him as our Savior. I want to end this part of our service with a song that I came across this week that is Joy to the World, but done in a very contemporary way in version, and it's going to help set the tone for us as we move into the Lord's Supper. So let this be our way.
Sorrows grow, no thorns infest the ground.